Good afternoon, everyone. How y'all doing today? Welcome to IAMTHEDATA podcast. I'm with my phenomenal host, Anthony Williams Jr. You know, we're actually looking at transforming adversity into advocacy and aspiring for presidential leadership. And this is my second time, you know, with Anthony on my show, which is definitely a pleasure to actually show we have greater aspirations for our lives, that we advocating for purposes that's going to save our lives and move us into a different regime. When we're looking at, let's say, 2040, what kind of people will we be in 2040? You know, will we be people that focus on leadership, focus on change? Will we focus on humanity? Will we focus on things? Will we actually go outside and say who has the best car or who has the greatest integrity, right? And this is when I talk to Andy. You know, he's talking about integrity. He's talking about aspiration. He's talking about hope for our people. You know, he's going for one of the highest offices in the land because, you know, everything trickles downhill. And he realized this, you know, we have both been through our obstacles in the land. I've been into a lot of different systems in this world. You know, I done lived like 1,000 lives already, right? And I got like 1,000 more to live, right? So it's like, you know, with that, I want, you know, introduce Andy. You know, my name is Daniel Evans. Please subscribe, you know, help us grow, build, reach higher plateaus. And with that, I'm going to let Andy speak his truth, and then we're going to have our conversation.
Hey, well, happy Sunday, brother. It's good to be back on the show with you. I know last time we had a couple of technical difficulties with me and this technology, but we rolling smooth. We rolling smooth. And it's just good to, you know, build with brothers, man, like-minded. In fact, one of the scriptures I was talking about today was in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 10, where it says, let there be no division among you. And that's where we all align with the same mind and the same judgment. And what that is part of the mission we have with our faith-based organization called We Are the People. And that movement is really about us recognizing 2 Chronicles 7:14 that talks about if my people who are called by my name, you know, would turn from their wicked ways. And I say that because the people have the power. We've always had the power. And then I look at the preamble to the Constitution, and it says, we the people, you know, in order to form a more perfect union. So the scriptures in the preamble to the Constitution, they align, they're in alignment. What is happening is that people take on these titles, these offices of these titles, and then they think that they can control and oppress people. And
that's right.
What we're bringing into this movement is to bring a new government. The scripture says, Christ said the government would be upon his shoulders, meaning all this weight and all this. Well, he defeated that. We still moving in a fallen state instead of a living state as people. So what we're doing with our We Are the People is bringing that solution out, bringing this movement out that's run by people and saying we the people are the majority. We're not the minority. So we the people have the right under the grand jury to nullify verdicts. We the people have the right to impanel our own grand jury, to form our own militia. And that's what the Black Panther Party was doing in the 60s. That's kind of the movement with the hippies, the Mexican Revolution. And I speak about all these different nationalities because this is a people movement, you know, for those that walk by faith and not by sight, but are looking to the scriptures. Show me in the scriptures where it ever talked about crayon colors, meaning black and white. The only time in the scriptures where it really talked about, you know, a color was when they talked about leprosy, you know, which in terms could also mean some of the people were albinos, but it never was about a separation based on somebody's skin color. It was always about the nationality. Like, you know, here's these Hebrews, here's these Ethiopians, the Hittites. That was all about a nationality of a group of people, all stemming from the 12 tribes, all stemming from a creator. That even, like I said, when we talk about the scriptures and the Constitution, it talks about our creator and nature's God. And those are unalienable rights that we the people have. So we just trying to, you know, set the record straight, say, hey, we are the people. Yes, we have a certain, you know, restrictions on how to represent we the people, but we welcoming everybody in.
Yeah, because I mean, you gotta have structure, you gotta have a foundation in order for us to basically springboard off. You know, you can't create a plan if there's no strategy, right? And you can't implement the plan if there's no strategy also. You know what I'm saying? So when we come into these new spaces, we need to understand, like, what is our assignment? Like, why did I come into this nonprofit? Why did I come on this advocacy movement? You know, whilst Andy is running for president and other individuals going to actually run for president with him as well, when that time comes about, why are we in these spaces and why are we doing this? I'm pretty sure, like, when I was on doing a presentation a couple months ago in front of City Hall, I was basically speaking to the men and women that was surrounding the space, you know, it was politicians, police officers, advocates, so forth and so forth. And I was saying basically, you know, the things that we do today, are we going to be able to come back 1,000 years from now and revisit those things and see what those things do to the people that we left behind us, right? We're not able to see this because we're not living for 1,000 years and 5,000 years in real time. So when we implementing certain things in the world, why are we implementing these things? Why are you taking these keynote positions and say, you know, I'm going to be the president of this organization, the vice president, I'm going to be the director, I'm going to be these different things, if it's not to actually change the framework of how we view it as a people and what's happening to us as a people on the land? If this is not the reason why you're doing this, if you're only doing this, it's like Christ said, he that saves his life shall lose it, but he that loses his life shall save it. If we're not looking at it from that perspective, right? The show I have is called I'm the Data. Why? Because we are the data of our change. We must bring forth the change, whether it's going to be an individual aspect or collectively.
I'm still here. I totally agree. When the scriptures talk, there's many members but one body. And that's what we're looking at it right now. There is no I and we. There is no I and we. You know, all of us have assignments. You know, I talk about the fivefold ministry, the apostles, the prophets, the teachers, the evangelists, and apostles. Yeah, apostles, prophets, teachers, evangelists, and pastors. I think that's the fivefold. So each one had a certain assignment, you know what I'm saying? And that's where we're looking at it, as to say, no, I feel God has called me to be in this position and not really to really have this big presidential leadership platform, but more of a servant leadership platform, because the greatest among you should be your servant. And historically, many of us has not seen that type of leadership. And so I invite people to study the life of Jimmy Carter, because Jimmy Carter, he modeled that leadership, that servant leadership. He modeled that. And that is where I draw my aspirations and inspiration from on a natural standpoint for those that are looking for a sign. And I say, look at Jimmy Carter's life. And it's not a coincidence that his initials are JC. I don't find that as being no coincidence, you know. And his wife just transitioned, and she was very specific about having Melania Trump be at her funeral, because she was a woman that believed in unity. So she extended the olive branch in her own words and said this. And I read that, you know, Brother Donald Trump and Melania Trump will be at, you know, that ceremony. So now you got the last living, sitting, current and former presidents going to be at that, you know, homegoing celebration. And I think that's what a kingdom on earth looks like. That's what the body of Christ should model. Because I may not agree with you does not mean that I hate you. My spirit just doesn't align with your spirit. But if I'm going to be about my Father's business in a reality, not just in lip service, not just in word, but indeed, we need to represent that. And that's what Mr. Carter, I think her name was Rosalind Carter. That's what she modeled. And he did too, you know. So that is where I draw, you know, a natural inspire to be. Like Jimmy Carter would be the Moses generation, and I would be the Joshua generation.
Hmm. Yeah, this is really profound because when we're looking at it from hindsight, right? You know, and if we was able to see things like a prospective level, you know, because we talk about retrospection, we talk about introspection, but if we look at things in a prospective level, that means that putting both of those components together in one unit to actually see what's going to basically form on these different trees that we're creating, what are going to be these different legacies that we're going to leave into the land when it's time for us to move forward. Because we may come down here and believe that we live like we're going to live forever, right? We don't want to give up these different plateaus that we have. You know, we don't want to pass, you know what I'm saying, the bucket, as you was talking about, that olive tree and passing on these different legacies. We may get into positions in the world, but these positions are not legacy-based positions. These positions, basically, once you finish your term, you're gone. You're not passing on any legacy as a vice president over here or president over here and things of that nature. In these organizations, even in these nonprofit advocacy components, there's no legacy that's involved with that. It's just a one-man, one-woman componency. And then after that, it just dies out. And then the next man gets put in there. And it's like, I wrote two articles on LinkedIn. One was standalone man, and the other one was standalone platforms. Well, both of them was basically the same because it was showing that individuals are creating these different platforms, but they don't bring people onto the platforms to ensure that these platforms continue with the same life and the same breath in which it was created under. So when they move on or leave the platforms or transition out, the platforms are basically coming to a wasteland. There's nothing there now. It's just straight dead. Another person like Andy got to come in and rebuild a platform. Another person like Nathaniel got to come in and rebuild a platform. Another person like Sojourner Truth got to come in and rebuild these platforms because the people that's on these platforms are leaving like a wasteland when they venture off from all of these different structures and off these different systems.
Right, right. If I was to really be transparent, we are the people is going to be the model for generations to come. It's so you could be a Democrat, you could be a Republican, you could be a Libertarian, you could be an independent. What we're really doing is teaching people how to be representatives. That's what that is, and not be politicians. Because when you are representative of all people, you have to hear from both sides and you have to be using the wisdom like Solomon did in the scriptures. You have to use wisdom. And in James 1, I think it's 1 verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, ask of it and I'll give it to you freely. What I feel like with the church or those that profess to follow Christ, instead of us transforming the world, we're conforming to the world. And then we wonder why we don't have no power, because the gospel of Christ has been watered down to become the gospel of man. And for those that would be listening to this right now and would say, oh, you know, here's this religious guy running for president. Make no mistake, I'm not that dude that you've had a negative experience with. Give me the chance, hear from my heart and not from the label that's associated with me. Because I would tell you, I'm from the tribe of Judah and I'm a Hebrew. You know, I'm Same the here. One that would tell you that those Israelites over there in Israel are not the original Israelites. And I would refer you to Revelation 2 verse 9 that tells you they're not the original Jews. So I'm saying that I'm going to give you the truth based on what I believe, but not saying it's the absolute truth, because you could teach me something that I was never introduced. And that's my reality of it. I'm not sitting here telling you that I got it all. I'm going to do 100% right, because the scriptures tell me that would be a lie. What I am telling you is I will surround myself around wise counsel. That is what I will do. And we're not looking for to buck a position to make a name for ourselves. We know that whosoever lifts up the name of Christ, they should be lifted up. And I'm lifting up the name of Christ for that to be a written model. You understand? I'm not asking nobody to believe it, because I believe it. And you can tell how I believe it by how I treat one another. So I'm not the one that's going to reject, you know, somebody's belief because they're, you know, in a same-sex relationship. What I'm going to say is we can't reproduce naturally in that. But if that's what you believe is yours, what you should do, I'm not in your shoes. I'm not in your spirit. I don't know your background. So I'm not here to judge you. I'm here to respect your decision and admit that mm-hmm. I'm not in alignment with that. But that doesn't mean I hate you. The gospel that I've been taught has been a gospel of love. And it says, this is how you know you, my disciples, by how you treat one another. So I'm saying we got to get the house straight first, you know, and I'm the one that's telling you that's the fruit that's happening in our home here with my wife and a blended family. So I can't be out mm-hmm. here trying to tell you I'm going to run your house or help you get your house in order if my house is in chaos.
This is not in order.
And that's being transparent. That's all I can give you. I can't, you know, give you something else, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you got to be extremely honest with your life first and who you are first. And then that actually going to translate into basically connecting with other people on a higher plane. You know, when you talk about planting seeds, you know, you got female seeds and you got male seeds, right? And they both have their different duties and they have their different parts. And if we don't plant the right seeds and we don't bring forth life with seeds, then that basically is like a generational curse to us. You know what I'm saying? Even for centuries to come, because the things that happened to us in the last 400, 500 years in this kingdom, I wasn't here, right? I came here in a new spirit, in a new body, right? And I wasn't there to basically bring forth a testament, actually, which I did and which I didn't do. But my ancestors still tell the tale. They actually still whisper to me at night. They still show me you and your books. They still show me who you are and your constitutions. When I actually go and look at your law books, it reveals to me who you are and what you are and what you have done in the land. So all I can do is actually make a testament according to what has been revealed to me, and actually looking at the present day times as well, when we're looking at different leaders that didn't make it, you know, to live their one generation of life because they stood on different plateaus and they challenged certain systems that was in place, and those systems are not bringing forth life. So if new generations are not born into the land, who is going to take the vision of Andy and modify it? Who's going to take that vision and grab it, you know what I'm saying, like a baton and run through the land and pass it on like it's hot fire, you know what I'm saying, to ensure, you know what I'm saying, that we're coming to a legacy of change for humanity? Who's going to do it? I was at a convention one time, and there was an old lady that came and talked to me. She was like 80 years old, and I never forget the conversation. She said, you know, Nathaniel, you know, you're talking about closing rackets. I said, yeah. And I'm talking about closing rackets because it's a system that has basically put humanity on the back burner instead of preserving humanity, right? You talk about, when you talk about you know, you're a religious person, you believe in Christ, you believe in Allah, you believe in these different people. These different people, you know, basically fell and rose, right? These different people showed us that there were second chances to life, that a man can be one day, one time, and the next time he could transform into something else. But now we created systems where systems are not allowing men and women to learn from their mistakes. They're not allowing them to learn from their failures and grow to new levels of beings. They're keeping us basically locked in and stagnant according to a purpose. And she asked me, you know, I was on Rackets Island campaign when I was 18 years old. And I'm like, yeah. She's like, I'm 80 now. Why do you think I'm here now? Why do you think I'm back on this platform? I said, because you didn't do the work that you're supposed to have done when you was 18 years old. You stopped doing the work. You jumped off the platform. You started building your own life. You got legacy positions. You started getting economical wealth and building houses and getting children, and accumulate all these different things. And now this basically beast that's in the land is still here, devouring life the same way it was 60 years ago when you was on the same platform. And she was like, well, what can we do? You know, what can we do to change this? I said, well, we have a system that's in place that basically promoting the loss of life. We have a system where you're talking about you got one CEO in one company. You're supposed to have 1,000 CEOs in one company, right? So they won't know who to move out of position so they can change the narrative of what we're talking about. We have to come as one unit and one people to dismantle these different systems. He's the CEO and she's the CEO. No, we all the CEO. All of us on the platform are the CEO. We come here to dismantle this thing. Why would we lease on the land that is not good for the people and that would devour the people and then turn around and say, he's the CEO of change? How is he going to be the CEO of our change? If it's billions of us and children in the world, how is one man going to be the CEO of our change, or one woman going to be the CEO of our change? That's impossible to do. So because of the system that y'all have created and how y'all actually have mapped in these different forms of change, we can't bring forth change. So this woman got to come back on the same platform 60 years later to do the work that she failed to do or chose not to do. And now she's questioning herself, did I do the right thing? And the Most High is telling you, didn't do the right thing. That's why I brought you back here 60 years later to see the harm that you left on the table.
No, and that's real talk. What I will say, though, is that between the Quran from Islam and the scriptures, that there's blueprints right there if we just would follow them. Or if we would just, you know, follow the message of the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have others do unto to you. Not what others have done unto you. Not what you believe others have done unto you. But that's not me saying that I'm going to let you run up on me and bust me in the head because one of my rights is the right to self-defense. So we're not saying that I got this, you know, I teach principles of nonviolence. I believe in the principles of nonviolence. But I also believe in the principles of self-defense. Because nonviolence don't mean I'm going to give up my life so you can be violent with me, because then there's no deterrent. And that's what we have to have. And that's where it comes into accountability. Because, you know, in another setting, the Lord disciplines those who he loves. We have to understand the word discipline also stands for discipleship, what also delves from the word relationship. So when we're disciplining our children, it's because we have a relationship with our children and we're trying to direct them. And we've been taught from generation to generation, well, I'm yelling at them, I'm doing this, I'm punishing them. And I think that there's the wrong concept behind that. There needs to be an administration of justice based on in the book of Zechariah 7, verse 9, I believe it is. The Lord administers justice, you know, shows compassion. He's compassionate and gives mercy. That's what we're supposed to do. But if we have not learned that, we're repeating this generational cycle, which turns into a generational curse or, you know, generational trauma or, you know, what I'm familiar with, whichever way we want to do. It's a stronghold. It's an addiction. And we are in a generation that we have access to solutions. Not only access to the solutions, but models of it. So when we say we, you know, there's a next generation coming after Andy, no, Andy's going to lead you to learn for yourself, not learn from Andy. Andy's a representative, but Andy is not your God. Andy is not your creator. Andy is applying for a position that has a job description that I believe I can align with. That's what I believe I can do. I have a job that I'm applying for, that I have a resume that shows that I'm qualified. And that's because that's what I believe. And so now what we do is we get the message out through these platforms here, and then the people get to take wind of it. And now they're saying, you know what? I'm hearing this brother. At first, I didn't know about him. Now I know about him. And then you catch a part of the story and then you think, oh, well, this is who he is. No, get the whole story. And that's why we're going to write the book. That's what we're going to put the documentary out. That's why we're going to have our own magazines. And that's, you know, when the gospel says, you know, preach the gospel to all nations. Well, what's the gospel I'm sharing? It's the good news that, you know, none of us should be perishing. That's the good news.
That's the good news. That's right.
None of us should be perishing. None of us should be looking at somebody that's representing division. And the biggest division we have in politics is between Democrats and Republicans. My heart is saying, I welcome Democrats, Republicans, libertarians, straight, youngsters, elders. Listen, if you wanted the people, I'm aligning with you. I'm not telling you, come join me. I'm saying, let me learn of you. Let me align with you. If you have an organization, stick to your organization. Because when you become a member of We Are the People, you're coming as one of the people. You're not coming as an organization. You see what I'm saying? And that's the difference. And if corporations wanted a tax write-off and they gave us some money, I'm going to receive it. Because I ain't no fool. We have a set of principles. And that's what we're going by. We have a set of instructions, you know, like the Bible says, basic instructions before leaving earth. We think that the role of government is wrong. I'm telling you, those that represent government have not been representing the job description because there's been no accountability, because they've been violating the missing 13th Amendment, that's the title of nobility, that did not allow lawyers to be elected officials. The judge was not an elected, the judge was not a lawyer. And so they've created a system, generation now, hid the truth, and now we following it, complaining about it, and now I'm saying, hold on now, we have the ability to be the change. We have the ability to be the power, which means we're no longer fighting the power. That was back in Public Enemy days. We are the power now. And that's where we're taking a movement of 300 people across these states to say, let us all run for office this time. Let's become the majority as people. Democrat, if you align with this abolishing slavery, freedom is our unalienable right because it's a birthright, then we can align with you. You know what I'm saying? But if you committed to your party, stay committed to your party. That's it. We ain't finna trip with that.
Yeah, we're not here to be your lord and to be your power. Right? You said a great thing as far as, you know, when I go on different platforms, I see people running up to people and basically like honoring people like they idols, you know what I'm saying, because they have a certain title or because they wrote a certain bill. You know what I'm saying? Or because they rub and shoulder with certain people, they make these people like God-like figures. And when you go on scriptures and you see the scripture where it's talking about poor and bottomless, as I put it there, when the people started worshiping poor and bottomless, they screamed out to the Lord and said, no, Lord, please forgive us. We did not want to bring forth this type of representation to who we are. We don't want no one to worship us. They ripped their clothes and they prayed to the Most High and said, no, don't worship us. And we got to get out of this space and worshiping other men and worshiping other women to make it seem like they're our God and they've got the vision of all visions for us. No, we, like you said, we are the people. We are the essence of our change as a unit. I always say on this platform many times over, I'm going to keep saying it. If we don't move like the ants and move like the locusts, we're going to have a problem. We got to move as one unit, one body. One mind, heart, spirit, and soul. If we didn't learn that from the Tower of Babel, then we need to start reading the Bible. If the Tower of Babel didn't show us that we got to move in one unit in order to bring forth change, because the Most High came and confused the people and gave them different languages and cultures and things of that nature so they would not become one mind, heart, and spirit to bring forth change. He said whatever they put their mind and spirit to, they're going to do because they are one. But now we're in the world and there's so many different separations all over the world. We got economical separations, you know what I'm saying? We got religious separations, we got cultural separations, you know what I'm saying? We got one nation annihilating another nation, all these different things. And then we want to run around talking about, we got this and we got that and we reached this certain plateau and I'm this amazing person. And I'm like, yo, listen, bro, it's like a lot of men that I came out of prison with, that I was in the same type of institutions with. They came home, they infiltrated these different systems, and then they don't bring us into the rooms so we can dismantle the different rooms. They don't bring us in the rooms so we can see what you're talking about in your boardrooms. They're not bringing us in the rooms so we can actually come in there to be the presenters and be the authors of the change, because we the ones that was locked behind cells. We were the ones that was strategized inside these different places. We the one that they was building and getting millions of dollars for every year while we sat in there, you know what I'm saying, and languished away, you know what I'm saying, and watch our brothers and sisters pass away while we was in there. I watched many of my friends pass away in those systems. So when I came out those systems, I'm like, you know what? It's not about Nathaniel. Nathaniel is a small pebble on a board, man. And I'm looking for other small pebbles on the board just like me so we could come together and we could create a boat and we could throw those boulders at different things that will not allow us to change. We've got come at these different systems that have been here like permanent fixtures for generations, for centuries, and they don't want to move. And when you go in places and you tell people, well, you know, your nonprofit look like a prison system to me. It's ran like a prison system to me. It's structured like a prison system to me. How dare you? Who do you think you are to come into our nonprofit and say that it runs like a prison system? Because I've been in your prison systems. So you want me to tell you how a prison system looks? This how it looks because I've been inside your prison systems. I've seen your hierarchies. I've seen your different levels of leadership. And I've seen these these blockages that you have created through your bylaws and things of that nature, that when leaders come into your organization, they come out as workers. They don't come out as leaders. You transform into workers instead of the essence of change that they're supposed to be. And then you wonder why your nonprofit is not blossoming. You wonder why your advocacy movement is being stale in the water, because you're not doing the things that you're supposed to do, which eradicate systems that you said you was going to eradicate when you was incarcerated. But once you come out, you forgot about that notion. It doesn't exist anymore, but it exists now that I can take my children to Disneyland for 6 months. I can go buy this fancy car, and I can go buy me a suit jacket for $1,000. This has now become your precedence for life. And it's like, yo, we need to move past those things because, you know, we have obligations and we have duties to do in the world. And one of those things that I believe is dismantle systems that actually go against human life on any type of level.
I totally agree. And that comes based back to the basis of saying, you know, we are the people. We are the people. And we have the power. And these systems that are contrary to what the people want is violating and infringing upon our unalienable rights. And I think one of the biggest strongholds that we have is facing these judicial officers that they've stole the identity from the book of Judges, but they're not the spirit in the book of Judges. That's correct. One of the things is you got these Pharisees and Sadducees, which Christ in the scriptures always say, woe unto these lawyers. Well, these same lawyers are these judges and prosecutors. So the thing is still happening that was happening back then, because I'll go back to it, because instead of us transforming the world, we've conformed to it. But the good news is we are the Joshua generation, and we're in the promised land, and we've rose up, and we'd rather obey God than man, and we're going to obey God than man in everything. Not saying we're going to obey God in this and this is how you live, but we're going to obey God in the fact that he tells us to love God, love your neighbor. That's the power. You know what I'm saying? We have the power to implement love, and you're not going to be able to love your neighbor if you don't love the guy that's in you with your whole mind, body, spirit, and soul. We ain't going to be about this lip service, but we're going to be about this fruit. And this is how you know you are my disciples, how you treat one another. You know what I'm saying? Greater love than this, John 15:13, than a man will lay his life down for his friends. If Christ is the one that laid his life down, then why do we have to? You know what I'm saying? If Christ conquered death, that was so we would be able to recognize we had eternal life. The system's in place. Listen, we're not doing no January 6th movement. What we doing is saying, let's get us 300 people across these states, like I said previously, like Gideon's army, and go around Matthew 9:35, preaching the gospel, healing all those that were sick and oppressed of the devil, and walk right on up. In fact, we say we pulling on up at the 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. You know what I'm saying? We pulling up because that's our house. You know, when we get there, Monday through Friday, it's the people's house. On the weekend, it's the Father's house. You see what I'm saying? So that's what it is. You ain't got to worry about trying to run up in our, just give us a call and set up an appointment, you know, because we got 1,000 presidents around here up there in Congress. That's right. Now. It's not just one. It's here. We have a cabinet. We got an inside circle. I got a special advisor. You know, I got wise counsel that comes from that Moses generation, which I look at as the 60s. We have that, you know. And that's where we're coming into this movement, saying we have a right to create our own government when the government that's in place right now has become tyrannical. And it's been that way, I really would want to say, historically, probably after Kennedy, you know. But again, I don't want to get to say when it started, because I think it was accumulation. Yeah. I just know once we got around here to this 2016, 2020, those elections were terrible. It's just a bad representation for our country that you have two people going at each other so much. And then what the people are saying, well, we got to choose between the lesser of two evils. I say, well, whatever you choosing And some of that is a reflection of who we are as a people. It's a reflection of us as a people. So you got to start with the man in the mirror. And if nobody represents your ideology on the way that you feel, we'll go up against that giant like David. And that's what we're doing. That's what I stepped up to do, to say, you know, in the 2020 election, nobody represented my interests better than me. Nobody was talking about abolishing slavery in the form of this mass incarceration. So I had to do it. Nobody was talking about creating a system of peace patrols. That's what I want. I'm not saying get rid of this, you know, quote unquote, get rid of the current policing system. I'm not saying abolishing the profession. I'm saying abolishing that spirit that's in them and implement a spirit of peace patrols. And here you are there when there's a breach of the peace, because we're not going to deny the fact that the majority of those that take this profession are not doing all the stuff we see on media. I'm not going to say that, because I know that's not accurate. I got too many people that I know, male and female, that work as police officers. I've been to their house, graduations, some of the police fundraisers and parties, and I respect and honor them. There's others that the current system, meaning the judicials and the prosecutors, are turning a blind eye to the injustices. So what the solution that we're bringing in this campaign with me is to bring back peace patrols. Because you can't call the police when there's a breach of the peace, and they're showing up being the breach. You know what I'm saying? We already calling you because there's a breach, and now you come and reacting, and you're coming in the same energy that we trying to neutralize. And that's the part that we have to say. And you know what? I don't have a vengeance, an eye for an eye. What I have is an accountability to serve as a deterrent. And when we rise up as our generation and say, listen, to the police officer, Derek Chauvin, whatever, that they said, you know, just got stabbed in the Arizona prison, I don't believe that that's what he deserved. I don't. What I believe is there's been such a unequal balance with that, that the people said, we're going to take laws into our own hands. That's what I believe. When you constantly see, you know, people of color or Hispanics or, you know, marginalized communities, that's what I'd rather say, marginalized communities that shooting each other from their own self-hate, as Tukey Williams has said it in the Peace Protocol, one of his books. It's a self-hate. So we lashing out at each other, and they're getting 30, 50, 60, 3 life sentences. But here, when you have another man or woman do the very exact same thing, you're saying, well, your profession, your job gives you a break. If the doctor messes up and does a surgery that's faulted, he don't get no break. He is penalized for that. Yes, he has insurance, but there's a penalty for it. And even I want to say Michael Jackson, the guy who was his doctor or whoever gave him that medicine, they sent that man to jail, you know?
That's correct.
What is the difference? The difference is we the people have not stood up and said, you know what? I don't know the whole scenario, but we can't keep allowing this to go on, because now we're operating in a spirit of fear that now we have a certain group of individuals that you think that's going to rise up and do what we've seen the majority on the media happen to them. They're going to do it to somebody else. And I'm saying, in alignment with Donald Trump, stop watching the fake news. That's all I'm saying, because that's not the whole news. And what we as believers have to do is share the good news. We ain't sharing the good news. Everything we talking about is negative, is a lower vibration. It's, you know what I'm saying? It's just constantly speaking death out of our mouth, because we're saying, well, that's the reality. No, that's not the reality. That's what has happened, but that's not the reality for the majority. And so what we get to do is to be creators, and we get to create a We Are the People. We get to create a government that's for the people, by the people, because we are the people. We get to create media stations that's spreading the good news. We get to be in alignment with churches. Pastor Mark Finley, my wife is at the SDA, which now I'm about to become a member with them. But his teaching style is so inspiring to me. You know what I'm saying? And I love that. I love my brother, Dr. Tony Evans. You know, I love Mike Murdoch. And the reason why, because each one of those has certain gifts. And I've been inspired by those gifts. But now those things that they've had, I feel like that's been transferred into me. And I get to take it to another level because we're reaching another generation. You know,
that's
so
right.
what worked for them is saying I was able to grasp that and then come here and be a mediator. Say, okay, this is what they're saying. This is what you're believing. Now let's see how we can align that. And that comes from me receiving that, you know, allowing the Holy Spirit to be my teacher, allowing the ancestors and what has been written to be a guide, which in closing, I'll say this, Frederick Douglass, you know, a Republican who believed that we had the power as a people of color to not ask for handouts. We had the ability to create. So here's Frederick Douglass in 1800s, and then you come to the 1920s and you see Black Wall Street, thriving communities with way less the amount of resources we have today, but they thrived and survived. It happened in North Carolina, it happened in Philly, you know, it was in Chicago. These Black Wall Streets were all over. Why are we steady talking about the past instead of learning from the past and resurrecting that? We have the ability to resurrect that, you know. Go to these institutions that give out grants and money with a blueprint. You know, one of the ladies with the Panther Party out in Oakland got $80 million and finna do a housing project. Take that model and blueprint. You know, Queen Latifah, she did a project out of New Jersey for housing. T.I. in Atlanta, he just opened up a housing project. Come on, y'all. These is people that's saying we ain't going to keep talking about the problem without providing a solution. So I'm not against talking about some things that were historically had happened. But if that's not motivating you to be something greater today, then bro, just stop talking, man. Damn. You know, yeah, I'm fed up with that.
Yeah, that's true, man. You know, it's like, you know, it's really coming together and really being those models of change that we see has to take place. When you're talking about Gandhi, when you're talking about be the change that you want to see in the world, you know, these are the things that we're talking about. And it's not, you know, say, well, he was a different nation and this and that. No, it's not even about that. It's about humanity. It's about life itself, teaching life from many different perspectives on how to actually be life. I mean, what is important to know to be life? I was on a platform a couple of weeks ago, you know, and a man came out of prison. He was like, he need help. And, you know, a man told him, yo, you got to have patience, you know, and I'm saying, you know, okay, I get the word patience. I understand what the word patience mean. But when you say you represent organizations and you represent these organizations from a certain plateau, a certain position, there should be things in place to assist in that thing of patience and not just tell a man have patience and then he could just walk off with that concept and not have real change that's taking place. So if you're not implementing real change in those different type of systems to ensure that we're dealing with immediate assistance, right? Where you say, you know, we're going to close rockets, but then you don't have economical structures in place to ensure when old men and women come out of rockets, they got housing, they're going to have employment, they can get emergency funding, they're going to be able to get a phone, they're going to be able to get the things that's going to allow them to restructure their lives and not repeat the same cycle or not bring new harm into our society by not ensuring that they have the tools and resources they need in order to bring forth a new consciousness. So yeah, you might dismantle this system and close this system and then one woman gonna get $1 million, another person gonna get $100 million as a bonus for closing these systems, but then the people gonna be out there just holding a bag and they ain't gonna know which way to go. So if you're not making sure that you have other components that's in place to ensure when you do close these type of systems, then you're just gonna leave people out there just to hang and dry, and they're gonna run into more devastating harm than they would have been in if they would have just stayed in Rikers Island, right? Right? So when we're looking at us as a people, what are the systems that we're actually putting into place to ensure that when we dismantle systems, that we don't create another harmful system in its place because we didn't dismantle system? It's kind of like the president, you know, Abraham Lincoln and whoever his constituents were, we're going to demolish slavery. but with no exit plan for the slaves. No housing, no economical stability. They out there in the street with bags and trying to find their family members. They didn't make sure that they brought forth family reunification. They didn't make sure that they established bank accounts. They didn't make sure that people had housing to go to. So and so, which actually gave way to the Jim Crow laws being constructed and being used as a tool, you know what I'm saying, to place us back into a different form of slavery under their penal systems, right? But if the president, before he dismantled slavery, if he'd have put these things in place, right, family unification would have been a primary. Economic stability would have been a primary. Housing would have been a primary. He didn't do those things. He just released them into the wild like they're animals, right, and didn't get them a direct directive to follow in order to basically establish their lives. So it's the same way you'll dismantle the prison systems, but you don't have any structures that's in place to ensure that the men and women are not just out there all frantically trying to find out what's going on with them, right? Mm-hmm. I remember I ran into a young man, and a man, he was crying on the phone, and I was like, yo, bro, you know, how you doing? What's happening with you, man? He's like, yo, man, you know, I just got out of prison. I don't got no money. I don't got no housing. You know, I don't know what to do, man. You know, and I was taken aback because, you know, this is a strong young black man, and he's standing on the corner, he's crying. And I'm like, wow, man, this is a legacy that, you know, we're going to a place that eat off of us, they drink off of us, they have us build all different types of mattresses and glasses and all different types of things, but we don't come out with any service certifications. We don't come out to housing. We don't come out to employment. We don't come out to a strong family reunification. And now we stand on the street corner crying, right? Because we don't know which way to go. So yeah, you could come out here, you could dismantle all these different systems, and you can make millions and billions of dollars by dismantling systems. But how do you prepare the men and women that's gonna come out of those systems that you just dismantled? And right. Then if you come in the spaces of judgment, if you judging one another, like he's not strong enough, she's not wise enough, she's not this, she's not that, we're all part of the same chain, right? You have your strengths, I have my strength, you have your weaknesses, I have my weaknesses. Don't try to put me, you know what I'm saying, in a nice little box, right? As if you created me, right? As if you're the purpose for my existence. You're not the purpose for my existence, right? Don't think that I'm a cool guy because I'm drinking Starbucks coffee instead of drinking Dunkin' Donuts. Nobody cares. Nobody cares. I don't own Starbucks. I don't own Dunkin' Donuts, and neither do you. You don't got no stocks in it. You know what I'm saying? You're not a part of the corporation. You may have a Tesla, but how many Tesla stocks do you have, right? Are you on a Tesla board? You know what I'm saying? These different things? No. So stop acting like you're a part of these different systems because you want to take money and brought into these different systems to basically partake of the riches of them, but you're not part of the riches of them. You're not part of the legacy of these different things that you're attaching yourself to and making yourself think that I'm a part of the whole now. I made it.
Right.
You know, I have arrived, you know, because I have this type of money and I have this different type of titles. So I have done a great thing. I've come out of prison, or I've come up for this situation, and now I'm better than my counterparts. No, this will keep us in the dark for the next 300 centuries, right? And maybe even though Andy and I won't be here for the next 300 centuries in true awareness and form as we are here now, it doesn't matter because it's still going to be in existence. So what we do in this time here, in these time periods now, is going to translate to the next centuries, even though we're not going to be here. And how do we get ahead of those things? How do we bring forth a new curving system to ensure that our children's children will not be plagued by these different systematic structures that they have or systematic disorders that they have created for us to actually feed on? You know what I'm saying? Like the Most High said in the Bible, they eat my people like bread, right? So it's like, you know, understanding what these systems have done to us and why have they taken form. And it wasn't to bring forth life. And that's the thing about it, is understanding who formed them and why they formed them. And where are these people that formed these different systems? Most of these people are no longer here. You're talking about somebody that was in the 18th century and the 1600s and things of that nature. They're not here. So they actually implemented different things. Like I told my daughter the other day, I said, you know, it's kind of ironic that, you know, they say that the black woman is so amazing, or the woman herself is so amazing. I said, you don't see one woman face on none of the money. You only see men on the money. Where are the women at? The women are so phenomenal, and the women are so precious to the world. The women are the earth of life, you know, the earth of life and things of that nature. Why aren't any women on any of the money that they circulate throughout the land?
Yeah.
Where are they?
You brought that up, and one of the things we have with We Are the People is we the people. So, you know, dealing with the hemp and the cannabis. And what we will be doing is creating our own form of currency made out of the hemp stocks and stuff like that. And what we will do is we will honor those men and women of all people, but primarily those people in community that have been overlooked. So, and as we begin to build this kingdom on earth, you know, and I don't want to say building a kingdom on earth, because it already has been built. But we represent a kingdom on earth where we're using this form of, you know, hemp currency as how we barter and trade. You know, so we circulate that around our own community. Because when we say we're setting up a new government that's written in the Declaration of Independence, or we're saying we're doing a new Jerusalem that was given to Ezekiel, you know, when he saw that what it was supposed to look like and with the 12 tribes. I mean that. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying we from the poor, because you can't pour new wine into old wineskins. You just cannot do it. And that's what a lot of us are still doing. We're just regurgitating and saying what everybody else is saying. And because I'm in the mainstream with the major candidates, I'm saying their conversation is not similar to the conversation I have. And I have a message for the masses that's not dependent on a November 5th, 2024 election. That anybody would be foolish to listen to Bernie Sanders. No, let's just go back to Bush and Gore when they said the election was stolen. Let's just start right there with Bush and Gore. And then Bernie Sanders, being a Democrat, said, well, the party stole this from me. And then you got all these allegations around Trump saying, well, the election was stolen from me. And now here you think I'm finna show up and believe that there's possibly not no truth in any one of those three scenarios and think that that could not happen? That's because I'm not depending on that system. I'm depending on the power of the people. That's what I'm doing. You see what I'm saying? And that's the angle we have to take. Because if the only way you can get something straight is through a vote, you've already lost. You've already lost. You should do what's right for people regardless of an election. And that is what I bring with the body of work from the 2020 campaign that I did. I never stopped being an advocate of advocate with the people. I'm not an advocate for the people. I'm an advocate of the people, because I'm one of the voices. I'm not the voice. I'm not the representative. I'm one of the representatives. I'm one of. And that is where I'm bringing, you know, from a personal standpoint, that's the vision that I have, to bring this nation back into unity with nature's God and a creator. And that has to embody people that are aligned, like I said, in 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10, that we're aligned in the same mind and judgment. That's how we have that. You know, to the atheist that says, I don't believe in a God, listen, I'm not telling you you have to, because what they're saying is you should just do what's right because that's what's right. What's wrong with that? Nothing. But you're so busy trying to push some religion down. No, you got to believe in God. You got to believe. No. I'm in alignment with you. You should do what's right just because that's what's right to do. You can't get mad at that. You can't get mad, you know. In fact, there was an atheist that talked to Reverend Ike, which he's one of my, and I'm going to close with this, you know, respectful of the time. But an atheist said, you know, prove to me that there's a God.
Got 6 minutes left.
It was a reel or something I saw. And the guy said, well, you prove to me that there's a God or something. And Reverend Ike said, well, I can tell you this. The God that you believe in is up in the sky. The God that I believe in is inside of me. And he said, that's where we're off at. Because that's the same thing I believe. God is a spirit. And it's the God in me. Scriptures say, don't you know we don't dwell in temples made with man-made hands? If we even follow the model scripture, it says, let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven.
That's right.
I mean, that's telling you, for me, it's saying, let us dwell among you. In Genesis, it said, God walked with Adam in the cool of the day. They was chilling. You know what I'm saying? Kicking it. And that's how I feel. Like, that's the vibration energy I'm rolling with. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because when you take yourself outside of yourself, then say, then what's left for yourself? If you believe that this entity is outside of you, then how does this entity actually live within you? How does this entity communicate with you and direct you and be a guiding force for you, right? If it's outside of you, right? When we're looking at external versus internal, we are internal beings. We know that some of us believe that we have a spirit. I do. You know what I'm saying? And that spirit is my heaven. It's connected to the spiritual being. You know what I'm saying? That's on a grandiose level, right? And then, like I was talking about here, you know, life, right? When you're looking at this money, there's no new life on the money. There's not people that's alive that's on the money. You're talking about old, colonial men that's on this money, men that have principles and concepts that do not resonate with the new times and the new order of things. They're no longer part of the new structure of life. So why would they be a representation of life itself? They're no longer part of new life. They're gone. They passed on. So we actually, like, as a friend of mine said yesterday, he was basically like, you know, everybody praises Malcolm X because Malcolm X is not here, right? And then Malcolm X is more prominent than men that's here. And then when I pass away, I'm going to be prominent now because I'm no longer here, instead of actually valuing life that's here, instead of worshiping things that are not here or entities that's no longer here. We are here in life. Right? And because we are here in life, we want to be a part of life. We need to be a part of life, and we need to bring forth these different changes that you're talking about in real time. We are life. These things that they have created, their money, the economical systems, the governmental structures, their laws and things of that nature, you don't find life in them. You go look at their law books, there's no life in there. It's saying if he do this, then she do that. But if they have this argument, and this argument is better than that argument, then this person could win. It's basically like playing a Monopoly game, right? No, we're talking about how do we deal with man and woman in real time, and how do we value humanity on a higher level than someone just coming out and being a dictator of different things, but they're no longer here. We're following old carnal laws and rules that was implemented when we was all asleep. And I say it and I keep saying it. When I was asleep, you created these laws. You created these statutes, you created these commandments, right? I'm awoke now. So why should I be subject to something that you created when I was asleep and now I'm awoke?
Right.
And with that, I will let you in it, you know what I'm saying? And it was always a pleasure speaking to you. This is a great conversation.
Yeah. If you want to hear more about me, make a donation to the campaign, because that is really where I'm at today. It's www.awj2024.com. www.awj2024.com. That's the website, and you'll notice that when it says about the funds we're raising, we're maxing out at $573 because that's what the role that I'm applying for pays.
Say the website one more time.
www.awj2024.com.
Okay. And I'm gonna put it up here so y'all can see it in real time. So that's it right there, right?
Yep, that'd be me.
Yeah, so you know, reach out, connect, you know, support the different changes that we have in the world. You know, our leadership is contingent upon one another. I'm literally using this game. You know, and we need to start recognizing that we have the power of unification, you know, amongst one another, right? We don't move, like I said, if we don't move like the ants and the locusts, we got a problem, right? We can't keep stopping and starting. Every time we create a Black Wall Street, it was destroyed. Every time we created different positions in the world to free ourselves of these different colonial rules and regulations, we were dismantled. Our leaders was actually uprooted and things of that nature, right? Good afternoon, Felicia. It's great you stopping in. We're actually ending in 20 seconds, but it's great to see you. you know, let's have a conversation too, you know. And with that, you know, welcome to IAMTHEDATA, you know, subscribe, support the channel, help us grow, help us reach great individuals like Andy. And with that, peace, everybody.
And love.
Hold on for a minute, brother.